Good morning all. Today we are going to see the production of the rotating magnetic field. So before going to this, let us first see the basics that are required. So let us assume if I take a conductor, I am just revising this. These things I have already discussed in DC machines. So I am just repeating it so that whoever are seeing this lecture for the first time, it will be useful to these basics. We will complete in 3-4 minutes, then we will go for the rotating magnetic field. Let us assume whenever the current is coming towards us, we represent by the dot. If the current is going away from us, we represent by the cross. We can find this, generally we represent by dot as well as the cross. So if you want to find the direction of magnetic field produced by this, the magnetic field will be surrounding these conductors. So if you want to find it, you can find by using right hand thumb rule. If you take your right hand, your curled finger indicates the direction of the magnetic field, where your thumb indicates the direction of current. In the case of first conductor, you can see the current is going inside. Your thumb will point into your book. So automatically your curled finger will indicate the direction of the magnetic field, because cross is going inside, dot is coming outwards. So the first case you will get this direction as like this, which will be counterclockwise direction. Whereas it is cross, it will be the clockwise direction. So this is the direction of the magnetic field. So let us see the case when two adjacent conductors are carrying current in opposite direction. You can see in the center the flux is adding to the each other, the resultant flux. Let us try to draw the flux because of the first conductor, because it will extend. So only first conductor I am taking just to analyze this. So in the outer side you can see the resultant flux is decreasing. Same thing is the case if you extend the flux because of the second conductor in first side, you will see the resultant flux will decrease. So we can conclude here, whenever two adjacent conductors are carrying current in opposite direction, a pole will be found between them. Again, if you want to find the direction of the pole between them, again you can use the right hand thumb rule, where your curled finger indicates the direction of current that is encircling. Then your thumb indicates the direction of the field. So you can see here this is cross, that means your fingers are going inside. Your curled fingers are coming out from here. This is dot. Then your thumb indicates the direction of the pole that is produced. If two adjacent conductors are carrying current in the same direction, we have seen there that the direction will be like this. So here also direction will be like this. So in the center, the resultant flux will decrease. Whereas in the outer side, if you extend and see, in the outer side, you will get it like this. Outer side, the flux will add to each other. So, or otherwise, we can tell that if two adjacent conductors are carrying current in the same direction, the flux will add to each other in the outer side. In the center, the net flux will become zero. Or we can tell this will be the direction of the flux. That means when two adjacent conductors are carrying current in the same direction, what I mean to tell, the flux of both the conductors will add to each other and the net MMF will increase. So with these basics, I am proceeding further to the production of the rotating magnetic field. So let us assume I have taken a machine where I have kept three conductors which are displaced by 120 degrees. I have taken the conductor A, conductor B and conductor C. They are displaced by 120 degrees. So let us assume this is my space angle, which is theta. And I am giving the current that is passing through these conductors. Let us assume the current is also displaced by 120 degrees Ia, Ib and Ic. So which is rotating with respect to omega t time. They are displaced by 120 degrees. So I can represent these as, for the A phase, the physical location. The physical location will be, let us assume the number of turns are n, into cos theta, cos of the angle, that theta is the space angle. Similarly, for the B phase, it will become n phase into cos theta minus 120, it is displaced by 120 degrees. Similarly, is the for three phase, third phase or the C phase, it is cos theta minus 240 degrees. Similar way, I can write the currents, Ia is equal to I maximum cos omega t. Then Ib is I maximum cos omega t minus 120 degrees, it is lagging behind it. Then Ic is equal to I maximum cos omega t minus 240 degrees. So we have studied that magnetomotive force MMF will be nothing but the number of turns into current passing through them. So n into I. N into I. So this I can calculate for each phase. So MMF I am representing with F. So F for phase A is equal to N phase cos theta, that is for N with respect to the reference, and the current is I maximum cos omega t. Or this I can write as N phase I maximum into cos theta into cos omega t. So this N phase multiplied by IM, I am taking as the maximum value of the MMF. So this I can write as FM cos theta into cos omega t. This is for first phase. Similar is the case for the second phase, FB. This will be equal to N phase cos theta minus 120 into I maximum cos theta minus 120. So this I can write as F maximum cos theta minus 120 into cos, the second one is omega t minus 120, right? Omega t minus 120. Sorry, the current is with respect to omega t. So similar is the case for the third one if you write. So this I can write as F maximum cos theta minus 240 into cos omega t minus 240. Let us try to see what will be the resultant value of MMF at any particular point. So if I want to calculate my resultant MMF wave, I am representing by F suffix R is equal to the sum of all the MMF, FA plus FB plus FC. So if you write that, this becomes F maximum cos theta into cos omega t plus F maximum cos theta minus 120 into cos omega t minus 120 plus F maximum cos theta minus 240 into cos omega t minus 240. So this I can write as F maximum I am taking out. I am just dividing and multiplying with 2. So this becomes 2 cos A cos B. I can write as cos A plus B plus cos A minus B. So cos A plus B plus cos A minus B plus second one also I can write in same way, cos A plus B, this become theta plus omega t minus 240 plus cos A minus B will be theta minus omega t, that 120 will cancel, plus for the third one cos A plus B will become theta plus omega t plus 480, whichever process, the 360, we can cancel that, so this becomes 120, sorry, this is minus 120 plus cos of theta minus omega t. This is the value involved. So I am just summarizing them again. This becomes F maximum by 2, 3 times of cos theta minus omega t. This is the one, this is the second one, but this is the third one. Plus, the next one is becoming cos theta plus omega t plus cos theta plus omega t minus 240 plus cos theta plus omega t minus 120 degrees. So we know that the sum of these three elements, because they are displaced by 120 degrees, having same magnitude, the sum, vector sum will be equal to 0. We have studied in the networks. So I can write this as the resultant value of 3 by times of F maximum by 2 into cos theta minus omega t. This is my resultant value of my MMF. Now if you want to calculate the flux, flux is equal to MMF by reluctance. So using that I can calculate my the flux, which gives the rotating magnetic flux. So from here we can observe that the resultant flux is a function of both theta as well as omega t. So two variables are there. So one variable if you fix, I can calculate my second variable. So let us assume I am fixing my value of theta and plotting the value of resultant value of the flux. Let us assume this is the maximum value. So now when omega t is equal to 0, if I am taking omega t is equal to 0, then omega t is equal to 0, if you substitute here, this becomes 3 times of Fm by 2 into cos theta. So with respect to theta, it will form a cosine wave. So this is for omega t is equal to 0. That means with respect to theta, it is becoming a sinusoidal. So now let us take a different case. So omega t is equal to 45 degrees. If you take omega t is equal to positive 45 degrees, because this is theta minus 45, when theta is equal to 45, it acquires the maximum value. When theta is equal to 45, it acquires the maximum value. So it will be something like this, because this is 90 degrees. So it will acquire the maximum value at theta is equal to 45. So it will be like this. So this is for the case of omega t is equal to 45 degrees. Let us take the case omega t is equal to 90 degrees. That means when theta is equal to 90 degrees, it acquires the maximum value. So the curve will be like this. This is for the case of omega t is equal to 90 degrees. So there are two ways of analyzing this. First thing is, for a particular value of theta, you can see as the omega t value is changing, you can see the magnitude is changing continuously. As the omega t is changing, the value is changing continuously. Or we can tell in another way, as the omega is changing, you can see the wave is shifting in the direction of the theta. That means, as the value of the omega is changing, it is moving at a rate of omega electrical radians per second. At that speed, it is moving through your angle theta. That means, if you take your rotor, this is my rotor, because this is my theta, initially maximum value at this point. So after some time, it will come to this point. After some time, maximum will reach this point. After some time, this point, and it will go back. So what is the speed at which this rotate? The speed at which this rotate will be omega. Remember, this is an electrical radians per second. So this is the speed with which the resultant MMF wave will move. So the major that observation from this is, we have seen that whenever three conductors are displaced by 120 degrees and the current passing through them is also displaced by 120 degrees, then your resultant MMF wave is equal to 3/3, 2 times MMF because of each wave, and this rotates at omega electrical radians per second with respect to the space. That means we can tell that this omega determines what is the speed of the MMF wave. We have seen the relationship between the electric and magnetic angles, that W electrical is equal to P/2 times of W mechanical. That means every pair of poles, it completes one electrical full complete rotation. So with assuming those things, so this I can write as omega electrical. Omega electrical will be equal to 2 pi f is equal to P/2 times of omega mechanical is equal to 2 pi n/60. Or from this I can write, so let us assume it is a synchronous speed. So ns is equal to 120 f/p. That means the resultant MMF wave will rotate at a speed of 120 f/p. F is the frequency of your currents. And that means the resultant speed at which your MMF wave will rotate will depends on the frequency of your supply and what are the number of poles. So 120 f/p. So in a generalized way, I can write that for the phases m greater than 2, the windings should be displaced by 2 pi/m radians electrical theta, and the currents are also displaced by 2 pi/m radians electrical. This gives the omega t. Then your resultant MMF wave will be equal to m/2 times of x maximum into cos theta minus omega t. And your ns, the speed at which your MMF wave rotates, will be equal to 120 f/p. So this you can take one example. If I am taking the number of phases is equal to 5, then they are physically displaced by 2 pi/5 radians electrical in space, and they are displaced by 2 pi/m, m is equal to 5 here. So radians electrical, this is for the current. Then your resultant MMF wave will be equal to m is equal to 5, because 5 phases, so this become 5/2 f maximum cos theta minus omega t, and ns will be equal to 120 f/p. This will be the speed. I hope this is clear to you. So next class, we are going to discuss the what will be the case for the two-phase system if you want to produce the rotating magnetic field, and after that we will see what is a double field revolving theory, because the same MMF wave, how it passes, can be even taught using the double field revolving theory also. So after that we will go for the constructional details of three-phase induction motors. So if you have any queries, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. Thank you. Thank you very much.